times prophesy is in the scripture lesson here, but we won't do that now. Nate, I should have let you read the sermon. I think I only say it once, so I'm feeling kind of bad about that. What a good job he does. Lauren, your turn is coming up. Just let me know. It is a land of dry bones. Ezekiel claims that Israel has become like a valley where thousands upon thousands of dry, brittle skeletons lie baking in the searing heat on the dusty valley floor. There must have been a terrible defeat of enormous magnitude in this place. What an appropriate text to prepare us for the events ahead of us about to unfold in Holy Week. Barbara Brown Taylor reminds us it is not Easter yet, but it won't be long now. The only problem is that we have to walk through a graveyard to get there. She suggests that those who don't have the stomach for it will stay home between the pomp of Palm Sunday and the glory of Easter. Most will only show up for the exhilarating, triumphal joys of the season, ducking out on the pain and passion. The rest of us, in our fear, will hang on to each other as we slip past the tombs, telling every resurrection story we can think of. But the reality is, to get to Easter, God first leads us through a graveyard of dried up bones. I'll be honest, Ezekiel is one of my favorite prophets. As one of the first apocalyptic authors, Ezekiel has a distinctive voice and a gift for descriptive visionary language, an innovative style. His word has transcended thousands of years because of it. When we enter into Ezekiel's world in the 36th chapter, he has just moved into his new condo in the foreign land of Babylon. His beloved Jerusalem has already fallen victim to its captors, and all the savory spice that gives Israel its particular distinctive flavor and individual taste among her opulent worldly neighbors is now being overpowered by the bitterness of bondage and smothered in the stench of destruction. It is a land of dry bones. This is where we find Ezekiel today in Babylon, trying to convince a weary, lifeless people to keep on keeping on, because God has been watching all that has been happening, and finally, Yahweh has had enough. Their God is about to speak in hot jealousy. The nations have, with utter contempt, taken you over and plundered you, Israel, and because you have become the object of gossip and slander and have been crushed on all sides, thus says the Lord, you, O Israel, shall soon come home, not because of anything you have done. You have done nothing worthy of my time and energy, but I am going to restore you for my sake, because it is my name, the name of Yahweh, that is being dragged through the dust, and I have had enough. I will vindicate Israel to protect my holy name. I don't know if you have noticed or not, but there seem to be dry bones all around us, kind of like the set out of Death Valley days. I find many people that I come across withered, wilted, and weakened, lifeless, and dried up. They work in the restaurants behind us on South Broadway, in the banks, the hospitals, and schools. These dry bones can even be found in churches. These bones walk and talk like whole people, but their spice, that savory ingredient inside that gives individuals their distinctive flavor, it appears to have lost its potency. Their hearts are pumping, but the breath is missing. Their eyes still see, but the vision is gone. Maybe it's because, unlike Esther, they didn't graduate from the University of Queens. Or maybe it's because they stayed up all night wrestling, but forgot to exact a blessing in the morning. I am not certain what has caused this zombie epidemic, but there are dry, brittle bones lying all around us. There must have been a defeat of enormous magnitude in this place. Like the Hebrew people, the foreign land in which we find ourselves is not unlike Babylon. The culture around us is lavish, sexy, alluring. It promises wealth untold and immediate gratification for our every whim. The marketplace is full of options to satisfy our unlimited craving for violence and power. We are called, like Ezekiel, to proclaim hope to zombies who don't have a clue they need it. Paul tells us to preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified. So we tell folks to take up their cross and return to the land of milk and honey, but they can't seem to hear good news in a cross. So we surrender our effort to speak foolishness against worldly wisdom, and we feel as Christians that there must have been a defeat of enormous magnitude in this place. And sometimes, the lifeless desert is even more intimate, more personal. It is our very own lives that seem to be plummeting into the valley of despair. The vultures of depression, illness, grief, or anger are picking the flesh from our bones, and we cannot for the life of us figure out how to stop the destruction. And yet we hear outside ourselves the voice of hope, the heart of the matter. It calls us to once again breathe deeply and take in the animating breath of God, the very winds of hope. Mortal, can these bones live? Oh Lord God, you know. Then prophesy to these bones and say to them, oh dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. I will cause breath to enter you once again, and you shall live and know that I am the Lord. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, as the bones came together, bone to bone. It is the very breath of God that knits the Israelites into a people that can walk through the valleys of slavery and exile and cause them to survive. It is the very breath of God that creates a sound of rattling in us as a community of faith, and lays muscle and flesh and strength over our dry bones and causes us to once again become the body of Christ. It is the very breath of God allowing us to serve and witness in His name to a world that is stale and stagnant with a stench of rotting bones without His love. It is the very breath of God that lifts us out of the graves of our living as though we were dead and fills us with hope and love and compassion and the will to live fully as God's own. This is the good news of the gospel. This is the good news to which we cling. There's a rattling noise around us on the dusty valley floor. Because you have become the object of gossip and slander and have been crushed on all sides, thus the Lord says to you, O Christian, you shall soon come home. I am going to open your graves and lift you out of them and bring you to the land of Christ Jesus. And I will put breath into you and you will live. As I listen to Ezekiel once again, I take a deep breath and I breathe in and I taste hope. That savory spice that makes us as Christians who we are. because it is God who creates new life in the midst of death. Jesus says, I am the resurrection, I am the life. And Christ leads us on a path that does not circumvent or go around the graveyard or the trials of our lives. It runs right through Good Friday on our way to Easter's joy. Let us make our prayer for this day be that God will continue to breathe new life into our living, animate us, give us new strength and muscle for our faith, that we can breathe the freshness of hope into our world. These bones, our bones, will live again.